And welcome back to Cloud Church. I'm Robert Breaker, missionary evangelist to the Spanish and English-speaking people. Last time, we started 1 Corinthians chapter 12, as we're going verse by verse through the epistles of Paul in order of when they were written. And we got from verse 1 all the way down to verse 11. So we'll begin today in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 12. Just to remind you, last time we talked about spiritual gifts and how at one time there were 9 spiritual gifts. And now there's only about 7 spiritual gifts that a Christian can have. And because the book of Acts is a transition, the church started by a Jew, Jesus, two Jews, and Jesus used the early apostles, and he gave them signs. He gave them miracles. He gave them gifts of healing and all that. And then God later said, you know what? The Jews rejected me. I'm going to call Paul. And God, well, let me put him up here. And God chose the apostle Paul as the apostle to the Gentiles. And so Paul was also an apostle. But when the apostles died out, so died out the signs and the wonders and the miracles. And we see that in Paul's life. Paul could heal people. But yet at the end of his ministry, Paul left Trophimus at Miletus sick. Paul had problems with his eyes and was losing his eyesight, and he couldn't heal himself. So the gifts of healing, the signs, 1 Corinthians 1:22, the Jews seek after a sign, but the Gentiles seek after wisdom. So back here, it was all about sight. It was all about those signs. But as the church age went on, no longer was it about signs and wonders. Faith cometh by hearing, hear by the word of God. The gospel, 1 Corinthians 15:1 through 4, is all about faith and believing in what Jesus did. No longer were signs or miracles necessary. Now, he changes from talking about those gifts to talking about the body. And the rest of 1 Corinthians chapter 12, almost all of it, he's talking about the body. What is the body? Well, this is called the body of Christ. In the church age, we have what's called the body of Christ. Now, some people teach that the body of Christ started here at the cross with Jesus Christ. That's one idea. Other people think the body of Christ started back here. Well, let's make this the second theory. The third theory is the body of Christ didn't start until Pentecost. And then there is another theory where people say, no, the body of Christ did not start until the Apostle Paul. And they say that the Apostle Paul was the first one in the body of Christ. We're going to see at the end of this chapter how ridiculous a statement that is when we get down to verse 28. So the body of Christ started when? Well, I believe the body of Christ started at the cross. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 2. In Ephesians chapter 2, in verse 13, but now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. Who are the far off people from Judaism? The Gentiles. For he, Jesus, is our peace, verse 14, who hath made both one. Both one. What does it mean, had made both one? Well, it's going to talk to us about the body and both one. The Jew and Gentile, when they get saved, become part of the body of Christ. So both Jew and Gentile become one in the body of Christ. And it says, and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us. Who's the us? Jew and Gentile. Having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself one twain new man, so making peace. The body of Christ is Christ's body. And in Ephesians chapter 5, it talks about how Christ and the church are one flesh, just as a man and a woman get married, they become one flesh. So Christ's body is the church, and the church is the body, so it's one flesh. So when you're both in the body, you're in one body. It's the body of Christ. But now look at verse 16. And that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereof. So the Bible teaches it's by the cross that God set up his body, which we know today as the body of Christ. So I'm not going to argue about when the body of Christ started. I think it's interesting how people love to argue, and that's one of the things that people like to argue about. When did the body of Christ start? Well, I know the body of Christ is called the church, and Jesus said he's going to start his church on himself. So I like to say that it's probably at the cross that the body of Christ, nobody was in it until later. But whenever it started, that's not important. If you get a chance, go to cloudchurch.org and look under Bible study videos. And I believe I have them there, one on, when did the church start? Another one, what is the body of Christ? When did it start? Might open your eyes and show you some things. But the body of Christ is the church. Now, we're going to go back here to Ephesians in just a second, because I want to read verse 19 and 20. But go to Colossians real quick. Because there in Colossians, it tells us what the body of Christ is. In Colossians chapter 1 and verse 18, and he, talking about Jesus, is the head of the body, comma, the church. Now, there are other verses that I could go to, but that right there tells you that the body of Christ is the church. The church is the body, and the body is the church. So what is the body of Christ? The church. What is the church? The body of Christ. Well, when you look at the church started with Jesus. He's the foundation of the church. Now, go with me then back to Ephesians chapter 2. In Ephesians chapter 2, the context is the body, verse 16, the body of Christ. There's one body. Now read down there a little bit in verse 19. It says, now therefore you are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints in the household of God. Gentiles are no more strangers. They're fellow citizens in the body of Christ. And now look what it says in verse 20. And are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. So over here, Jesus is the chief cornerstone, the Bible says. Well, the cornerstone is what you lay when you're starting something. Jesus Christ was the cornerstone that started the church. Well, if the church is the body and the body is the church, then Jesus Christ is the body of Christ. And all people who trust him are part of the body of Christ. So the body of Christ must have started with Jesus Christ. Now, the thing that many people don't understand is that the Jews got into the body one way and the Gentiles got into the body another way. You say there was two different ways to get into the body of Christ? I've never heard that. Yes, there's one way and one way alone to get into the body of Christ. You have to be baptized by the Spirit. Now, here's what you do. You go through the book of Acts and you rightly divide. You understand the book of Acts starts with Jews and then it changes and goes to Gentiles. Clearly the Gentiles are baptized with the Holy Spirit the moment they believe. So by faith, the Gentiles are baptized into the body of Christ. So the question is, how were these old Jews at the beginning of the church baptized into the body? Had to do with something else, and we'll look at that in a minute. So Jesus Christ built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets. So the apostles, that means the body of Christ, the foundation of the church, the body is the apostles. Which means those Jewish apostles had to have been a part of the body of Christ. But they weren't trusting in the gospel of 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. So how did they get in? You see, most people don't understand. When Jesus died, he was a Jew who died for Jews. Jesus said he came not but for the lost sheep of the house of Israel. He came as their Messiah, and they could have accepted him as Messiah. But the nation of Israel as a whole, when they stoned Stephen in Acts chapter 8, rejected their Messiah. That's when God said, okay, no longer going only to Jews, now I'm going to Gentiles. Now I'm going to show people it's all about what I did on the cross to save them. And guess who shows up in chapter 9 of Acts? Paul. Chapter 10 and 11, it's all about Peter preaching to Gentiles. Wow, that's interesting. Chapter 13, Paul is sent out on his first missionary journey. So there is obviously a change from Jews to Gentiles, and from Peter and the early apostles to Paul. Why? Why is there a change? Why is Paul in the Bible? Paul is the apostle to the Gentiles. And if you get a chance, go to cloudchurch.org under past sermons and check out the sermon I did on the difference between the who and the what of salvation. Because it explains so much on the difference. How when the Jews started and the apostles came, all their preaching was about who Jesus was. And they continually said, believe in Jesus, believe on his name, believe in who he is. It was all about the Jews accepting their Messiah. That's who Jesus was. But as the nation as a whole rejected their Messiah, God says, all right, now it's all about what I did for your sins, for your justification. You see, Peter and the early apostles, they preached Jesus died and was buried and rose again. Jesus died and was buried and rose again. Jesus died and was buried and rose again. And they repeated that over and over as a murder indictment to the Jews. Hey, you killed your Messiah, but he rose again. Now, when Jesus changed, when God changed from the Jews to the Gentiles, in chapter 13, I believe it is, that's the first time that the gospel, the death, burial, resurrection, was for your justification. It was for your justification. It was all about what Jesus did. No longer was who was Jesus, the Messiah. Now the gospel is going to the Gentiles, and the gospel is what happened. Why did he do it? What was it for? It was to save us. It was to justify us. It was to give us eternal life. And when you trust the gospel, that's when you are baptized by the Holy Spirit. Now let's go back to 1 Corinthians. And we're beginning there in verse 12. For as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ. Three times it tells us that the body is one. There's only one body of Christ. There's not two. I've talked to people before and they say, oh, there's two bodies. Yeah, there's this body, but that's not the body of Christ. That's just another body. The body of Christ starts with Paul. Well, we just read that the body of Christ is the church. And the church started with the apostles. So the two were made one by the cross. The middle wall partition was taken down, and before they were strangers, now they're fellow citizens in the household of God. So it must have started back here. So the difference is the Jews got into the body differently than the Gentiles. And how is that? They got in by this preaching. Let's go back to Acts. Then we'll begin reading again in 1 Corinthians. But in Acts, these Jews that got saved, they received the Holy Spirit. In Acts chapter 2, verse 36, Peter is preaching, therefore let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made that same Jesus whom ye have crucified, both Lord and Christ. Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, comma. Now watch this. And ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. So these early apostles were preaching, you have to be, if you're a Jew, baptized in water. It was all about the water baptism. I put a Z. See, when John the Baptist came, he came preaching the exact same thing. And old Peter almost sounds exactly like John in Acts 2.38. And you know what's sad? There's people today that think Acts 2.38 is the way to be saved. They don't read the rest of the Bible. I wonder why they haven't ever read Acts 16.30 and 31, which says, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. It doesn't say, get baptized in water. It says, by faith, by believing, you're saved. So there were two different people that God began to deal with as the church began. And God told these early Jews, you've got to be baptized in water. And when they were baptized in water, they received the Holy Ghost. They were baptized in the Holy Spirit at the same time. But today, we who are Gentiles that get saved, that doesn't apply to us. We don't get saved by water baptism. How do we receive the Holy Spirit who are saved? Well, it's not by water baptism. Go over to Ephesians 1:13. Today, the very moment you believe, you receive the Holy Spirit of promise. Ephesians 1:13 says, in whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. So the Bible teaches that in this time, before Acts chapter 8, to be baptized into the body of Christ and to receive the Holy Ghost, those Jews had to do something. They had to be baptized in water. And when they did, they got the Holy Ghost and they became part of the body of Christ. Now they knew nothing about the body of Christ. God revealed unto Paul later what the body of Christ was, and then Paul revealed unto them, hey, you know why God died on the cross? To make himself a body of both Jew and Gentiles. And we're going to see that in a minute in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. So there you go. Over here, it's all about believing. We receive by one baptism. And that one baptism is a spirit baptism. No water baptism saves us today. No Gentile is saved by water baptism. Now go back to 1 Corinthians. Well, no. Before you go to 1 Corinthians, go to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians 4 and verse 4 says, there's one body. Well, we just read that in Ephesians, or in 1 Corinthians 12:12. For there is one body. One body. One body. Three times it says there's one body. What about these people that try to make two bodies? The Bible continually tells us there's only one body. There's only one body. But in Ephesians 4:4 says there's one body, one spirit, even as ye are called in one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. The faith for today isn't that faith of be baptized in water to receive the Holy Ghost. The faith today for us who are saved, because Paul, according to Romans 11:13, is our apostle, is faith in the gospel. One baptism. Which of these two baptisms is the one we receive? Or do we receive water baptism for salvation? Or we receive the one baptism, which is spirit baptism, and we are baptized with the Holy Spirit the moment we believe? It's this one. What's so sad is how so many churches today can't rightly divide the Word of God. The Bible tells us in 2 Timothy 2:15, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that not readeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the Word of truth. People don't rightly divide. So what do you have? You got a Catholic church that doesn't know anything about Paul. They want to say they were founded on Peter. And they say water baptism is what takes away sin. So they'll baptize babies and say that took away their original sin. They don't understand. That's not the one baptism according to Ephesians chapter 4. You've got Pentecostals. I say Acts 2:38. You've got to be baptized in water to receive the Holy Spirit. They don't see that that's to Jews. So these people are dying and going to hell because they haven't rightly divided the word of truth. And they're trusting in water baptism and in their works rather than in the gospel, which is salvation by faith in the finished work of Jesus Christ. Now, with all that, it all comes back together in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 13. 1 Corinthians 12:13 says, for by one Spirit are we all baptized. And who is the all? All of the church. Everyone who's saved. Either they were saved back here by this way, or they were saved over here by faith alone. For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body. Now watch what it says. Who is baptized into the one body? Whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, we've all been made to drink into one Spirit. So these Jews that were baptized in water and believed that their Messiah was the one that was Jesus, they got the Holy Spirit of God when they were baptized with water. We Gentiles who got saved on this side through Paul's gospel, we were baptized with the Holy Spirit of God the moment we believe and sealed with the Holy Spirit. And it says, for by one Spirit, it's the same Holy Spirit on this side as on this side. So the Holy Spirit baptized these Jews into His body one way, but He baptized us into the body through faith. And both were baptized with the same Holy Spirit. They received the Holy Spirit back here, these Jews. Today, when you get saved, you receive the same Holy Spirit that they received. It's just different way that they received it. That's called dispensationalism. That's called rightly dividing the word of truth. You read the Bible, that's the only way you can see it. Because either we're saved like this, and Paul's a liar, or we're saved like this, and God phased and changed from them to us. Well, God ain't no liar. So this must be the way that it worked. And so that means there's one body of Christ, and it says all baptized into one body, whether be we what? Whether Jews... Well, the Jews, that's this side, or Gentiles. So the body of Christ is made up of both Jews and Gentiles. And they're both in the same body. How many bodies are there? There's one body. One body. And so many times the Bible tells us one body, verse 12 again. It says one body, one body, one body. And then verse 13, for by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body. And then verse 14, for the body is not one member, but many. The one body has many members. You see, who are the members? the members are Jews and Gentiles. So it's one body with many members. Who are the members of this body, the body of Christ? Many Jews, many Gentiles. Today, whether you're a Jew or a Gentile, the only way to heaven is through this gospel. Back here was what Peter preached. And by the way, Paul straightened Peter and the early apostles out and said, by the way, God revealed unto me some mysteries. There's seven mysteries in the Bible. If you get a chance, go to cloudchurch.org. I'm preaching on the seven mysteries right now. God used the apostle Paul to reveal certain mysteries. And one of the mysteries was the mystery of the body of Christ. And Paul told those early apostles, this is what God's been doing. And those apostles came over to this gospel and realized that was only for Jews, but this is for everyone today. Even Peter began to preach to Gentiles. Okay, so now we see what the body of Christ is. It started by the cross, and it has Jews and Gentiles alike in the one body. The only thing is they got in a different way. In the early part of the church, to get the Holy Spirit, you had to be baptized in water. But as the book of Acts continued, and the book of Acts is a transitional book, Israel turned away from God as a nation. Individual Jews were saved, but God told Paul, look, reveal unto my church, my body, that this is the way it's going to be from now on. You're saved by faith alone in the finished work of Jesus Christ. You receive the Holy Spirit the moment you believe. So the body is not one member, but many. So the body of Christ is this. Here's the body of Christ. Well, the Bible tells us that when we're saved, we are in Christ. What does that mean? It means we're in His body. But the Bible also tells us when we're saved, we have Christ in us. These are some of the mysteries that we talk about in the seven mysteries. So when you're saved, this is your body. You have the Holy Spirit of God inside of you. But when God looks at it, God looks at it as when you're saved, you're in His body. And this is Jesus' body. So you've got Jews in this body. You've got Gentiles in this body. It doesn't matter. There's no dividing. Whoever they are, whenever they got saved, whether it was back here, under this way, or over here through the gospel this way, now they're all in His body. And whose body is this? This is Christ's body. The body of Christ. And now, the Bible is telling us here that as a body has many members, so are there many members in the body of Christ. Well, you've got 10 toes and 10 fingers. You've got 2 eyes, a nose, a mouth. I mean, there are a lot of members in the body, a foot and a hand. And that's what we're going to read here. So verse 14, for the body is not one member, but many. So it's one body, but many members. If the foot shall say, because I am not the hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the foot say, what's the foot doing? The foot says, I'm no longer part of the body of Christ. He's asking the question, is it no longer part of the body? These people that say you can lose your salvation, how crazy is that? There are people out there that say you're saved by works. And that you can get saved, but you have to keep your salvation by works or you can lose it. Really? Can Jesus cut off part of His body? You see, the picture, the illustration is, this is Christ's body and you're saved, you're part of His body. And when you're there, you can't get out. Jesus Christ isn't going to cut you off and say, I don't need you, and cut His hand off. That's ridiculous. That's sick. So it says, verse 16, that the ear shall say, because I'm not of the eye, am I not of the body? Is it therefore not of the body? No, it's still part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where were the hearing? Or if the whole were hearing, where were the smelling? The body isn't just one or the other. The body isn't just Gentiles. The body isn't just Jews. It's both Jew and Gentile alike. And then interesting that a body has 2 parts, 2 eyes. Jew, Gentile. 2 arms, Jew, Gentile. 2 legs, Jew, Gentile. I mean, 2 ears, Jew, Gentile. The body of Christ is made up of both Jews and Gentiles. Verse 18. But now hath God set the members. Now watch this. Every one of them in the body as it hath pleased Him. I've come into people and come around people and they say, I just don't understand this. I can't believe. I think the body is only Gentiles under Paul. And Paul was the first in the body of Christ. This verse I like to show them. He says that God set the members in the body as it pleased Him. They say, I just don't understand how God could put these people in the body. Because it's a different gospel. He did it because it pleased him. And the way he did it was as it pleased him. It pleased God to do it this way. That's the way he did it. That's what the Bible says. You either believe he did it that way or he didn't. You don't have to understand it. All you have to know is that he did it. He put the Jews in the body. They got saved by being baptized in water and got the Holy Ghost. And then he said, that's enough of that. No longer to the Jews because the nation rejected me. Now it's through this gospel by faith alone without being baptized in water, because baptism in water does not save you. You're saved by believing, and you receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit the moment you believe. And then those people are in the body. Jew and Gentile alike, as it hath pleased him, he put them in. That's just the way God said. It's all what pleased him, not what pleased us. I get so tired of people trying to over-divide the Bible. The Bible says rightly divide. There are people that don't divide at all, so they wrongly divide. It says rightly divide. There are people that divide too much, so they wrongly divide. There's a right way to divide the Bible and a wrong way. And there's some people that wrongly divide the Bible because they overly divide it, and they leave these Jews back here out of the body of Christ. When we get to verse 28, you will see that you cannot leave them out of the body of Christ. They are in the body of Christ. So God put them in as it hath pleased him, just as God used Paul to get them in as it hath pleased him. If you don't like it, well, I guess you just don't like the scriptures, because that's what the Bible is teaching. Verse 19, if they were all one member, where were the body? That's a good question. Now are they many members, yet one body? So it is one body with many members. And what are the many members? Both Jews and Gentiles in the one body. Verse 21, and the eye cannot say unto the hand, I have no need of thee, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. Nay, much more, those members of the body which seem to be more feeble are necessary. And those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, upon these we bestow more abundance honor, and our uncomely parts have more abundant comeliness. Now think about this. The Apostle Paul is a Jew. And he's writing to this church. And the church is Gentiles. And the Gentiles have always hated Jews. And so they look down on Jews. Now Jews have always looked at Gentiles and looked down on them and said, oh, we don't like them. So what is he saying right here? But those members of the body which we think to be less honorable. Well, a Jew wouldn't honor a Gentile, and a Gentile wouldn't honor a Jew. So that'd be hard for them to think that they could be in the same body. But he says, hey, they are. Upon these we bestow more abundant honor. A Jew that's saved should honor a Gentile that's saved, because they're one in Christ, in the body. A Gentile who's saved, even though he might not like Jews, should honor the Jews, because they're in the same body in Christ. That's what the verse is saying. And our uncomely parts have more abundant comeliness. For our comely parts have no need, but God hath tempered the body together, having given more abundant honor to that part which lacketh. Well, which is the part that lacked? The Gentiles. You see, in this body of Christ, there are more Gentiles saved than Jews. Isn't that something? All throughout the Old Testament, there are Jews that were saved under the law. And under that law, Gentiles couldn't get saved. No Gentile could get saved under the Old Testament law unless he converted to Judaism and actually became a Jew. Have you ever thought about what that means? That means snip, snip. That means he has to actually go drop his drawers and allow himself to be circumcised, because he had to be under that Old Testament law to be saved. Now today, God told the Jews, here you go, I'm here, I'm your Messiah, you can take me. And the Jewish nation, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, they said, we will not have this man to rule over us. We don't want you. And so God said, okay, Gentiles, now it's your turn. You see, this only took place in about 10, 20, 30 years after Jesus. And here we have 1,900 years in which Gentiles have a chance to be saved. We find it prophesied in the Old Testament. It's definitely there. In the Old Testament, God said that he would bring salvation to the Gentiles. And the Apostle Paul even tells us about that. Go to Romans chapter 15. Romans chapter 15. And let's look at verse 8. Verse 8 says, now I say that Jesus Christ was a minister of the circumcision for the truth of God, to confirm the promises made unto the fathers. So Jesus was a minister of the circumcision. Jesus was a Jew to Jews. That's what it's saying. To give them the truth of the promises made to the fathers, the Jews. And you know what? The Jewish nation blew it. They rejected their Messiah. Now look at verse 19. and notice that that sentence doesn't end in verse 8. It's a semicolon. Is that a colon? I guess it's a colon. And it says, and that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy, as it is written, for this cause I will confess to thee among the Gentiles and sing unto thy name. So Jesus came only to the Jews. And for the Gentiles. That's why Paul was called to take this, the gospel, to the Gentiles. And look what he says. All of a sudden, Paul starts to begin quoting Old Testament passages about salvation going to the Gentiles. It says in verse 9, as it is written, for this cause, this was a quote from Psalms 18:49, for this cause I will confess to thee among the Gentiles and sing unto thy name. A quote from Deuteronomy 32:43 in verse 10, and again he saith, rejoice ye Gentiles with his people. Then he quotes Psalms 117:1 in verse 11, and again, praise the Lord all you Gentiles and laud him all you people. Hey Gentiles, praise God because he gives you salvation. Because the Jews rejected him, you can be saved. Now the Jews that didn't reject him, those apostles and the ones that got saved, got in the body. And then the Jewish nation as a whole rejected Jesus. Now there were still people that were Jews getting saved under Peter and Paul. But eventually Paul went only to the Gentiles. But everywhere Paul went, it seems like he went to the synagogue first. And look at verse 12 in Romans chapter 15. Again he quotes an Old Testament, and it's Isaiah 11 verses 1 and verse 10. And it says, and again, Isaiah saith, there shall be a root of Jesse, and he that shall rise to reign over the Gentiles, and him shall the Gentiles, what? Trust. In whom ye also trusted, Ephesians 4. Salvation is by trusting. You trust the gospel if you're a Gentile, and you get eternal life. You get the Holy Spirit. You become part of the body of Christ. So God prophesied in the Old Testament that he would bring to the Gentiles salvation. He did. He really did. And he brought it to the Jews, but he told the Jews, now get baptized in water to identify with me that I'm the Messiah. And believe in my name and you'll get the Holy Spirit. And they did. But the nation as a whole rejected him. So God said, okay, Peter, go over to these Gentiles and preach to them. Okay, Paul, come here. Get saved and go over to these Gentiles and preach. And now we Gentiles can stand up and say, oh, God, I praise you because you made a way for me to be saved and I don't have to become a Jew. I can be saved through the gospel. Well, let's go ahead and read Romans 15:13. Now the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing that you may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. Now I forgot to read verse 16, so let's read verse 16. Romans, I'm in Romans still. Romans 15:16, Paul says, that I should be the minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles, ministering the gospel of God, that the offering up of the Gentiles might be acceptable, being sanctified by the Holy Ghost. So Paul's ministry was mostly to Gentiles. Now he always preached to Jews first, because he loved his nation. But he had to preach this as the way of salvation. So when the book of Acts began, after Jesus died, there were Jews getting into a body, the body, in a certain way. But when the nation as a whole rejected their Messiah, God said, I'm going to change it now. I'm going to make it salvation not by works or something you do, being baptized. Now it's by faith alone, trusting in the gospel. And you'll be baptized by the Spirit into the body of Christ. Now with that, return with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 13. For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles. It says we have all been made to drink into one Spirit. One Spirit, the Holy Spirit. Through the one Holy Spirit, they were baptized into the body, whether Jews or Gentiles. Now, we stopped in about verse 25. So let's go to, let's continue verse 24 and then go to verse 25. For our comely parts have no need, but God hath tempered the body together, having given more abundant honor to that part which lacks. Well, the one that lacked was the Gentiles because it was hard for them to get saved under the law. So he gave more abundant comeliness to the Gentiles. I'm sure that made the Jews mad that God was working and dealing with Gentiles. They didn't like that. They didn't like that. Verse 25, that there should be no schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care one for another. So the Jews should love and care for the Gentiles, and the Gentiles should love and care for the Jews. Go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, I believe it is. In verse 32, I go back to this verse a lot. But 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 32 tells us there's only three groups today in the eyes of God. Give none offense neither to the Jews, nor to the Gentiles, nor to the church of God. So when God looks down on this earth, He sees three groups. He sees people that are Jews that are lost. He sees people that are Gentiles that are lost. But then He sees His church, His body. He doesn't see if it's a Jew or a Gentile. If a person's been saved, baptized, and is part of the body of Christ, as far as He says, they're part of my body. They're a member in my body. So there's no Jew and Gentile in the church. Whether you were a Jew or whether you were a Gentile, when you're saved, you become part of the body of Christ. And you are in Christ, and you have Christ in you. The hope of glory. So now let's go to verse 26. Over here in verse 26. And whether one member suffer, all the members suffer with it. Or one member be honored, all the members rejoice with it. So here we have him talking about the body of Christ. And who is in the body of Christ? Jews and Gentiles that were saved. Under this time, you could be a Jew that got in by trusting in the name of Jesus and being baptized in water and you received the Holy Ghost. But that's phased out as God changed from Jew to Gentile. Now, one thing a lot of people don't understand, after the rapture, who's leaving at the rapture? The church, the body. The body of Christ will be gone. And that's when God will again go back to the nation of Israel and deal with that nation once more. Now, that's prophesied in Romans chapter 11. That's one of the seven mysteries. Again, go to thecloudchurch.org. Look up the seven mysteries. I've been preaching on the seven mysteries in the Bible. One mystery every Sunday. And the last of the seven mysteries that I've spoken about is this last mystery. So you see, when Jesus came, there's a transition from Jew to Gentile. But when Jesus comes and takes His body out, there's a transition from Gentile to what? To Jews. Isn't that amazing? Many people have preached this, and I believe it, that this church age time is almost a parenthetical time. It's almost like a parenthesis. On God's calendar, this could or could not have happened. Because had those Jews as a nation accepted their Messiah, then the tribulation would have started right there, and then the millennium. And that Old Testament prophecy of the Jews one day coming to God would have been out here in the millennium. Excuse me, the Gentiles coming to God would have been out here in the millennium when the Gentiles would have come to God, which they still will in the future. But Paul applies those passages in Romans that the Gentiles praising God are the Gentiles here that got saved. So this is a parenthetical period. And you know, this period was really hidden in the Old Testament. There were a lot of Old Testament prophets that didn't understand the church age. They just didn't see it. I believe that it's in the epistle of Paul where he says they diligently inquire. Let me see if I can find that for you real quick. Let's go to Peter. Peter, here we go. 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 10, Peter says, of which salvation the prophets have inquired and searched diligently, who prophesied of the grace that should come unto you. Well, the church age here under Paul, and we're saved by grace. So these Old Testament prophets were over here prophesying of the grace to come, but they didn't understand what they were prophesying of. Because it continues in verse 11, 1 Peter 1:11, searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ which was in them did signify, when it testified beforehand the suffering of Christ and the glory that should follow. Unto whom it was revealed that not unto themselves, but unto us they did minister the things which are now reported unto you by them that have preached the gospel unto you by the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven, which things the angels desire to look into. So all this before Jesus Christ died, from Genesis all the way up to Malachi, and then Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. There's prophets that prophesied Jesus' coming, His suffering, and His glory. Over here was the cross. That's the suffering. Over here, when He comes in Armageddon, that's the crown. That's His glory. So they prophesied of that and that, but they didn't realize that is going to be in the middle. And so it says even the angels looked into that. You see, when Jesus came, the angels didn't even know why He came to earth. What a mystery. Can you imagine being an angel in heaven and you're sitting up there with God And all of a sudden, one day, Jesus Christ gets up off his throne and says, "Is it time, Father?" And God the Father says, "It's time." And Jesus says, "Okay." And Jesus just starts descending down from heaven. And all the angels are looking around, scratching their head, and they're going, "What, Father, why is he, where is he going?" And God the Father says, "I can't tell you. It's a secret." And so Jesus Christ comes down, and he's born of a virgin. And he's on this earth, and the angels are in heaven looking down, watching Jesus Christ as a child, watching Mary change his diapers, watching Jesus grow as a little kid and, you know, stub his toe and fall and hit his head and run to Mary and cry, and she's holding him, and they're up in heaven going, "Why has Jesus become a human, and he's allowed himself to be, what?" And they watch Jesus get older, and he's a carpenter, and he's 12, 13 years old, and he's working in his daddy's shop. And the angels are up in heaven, "What is this? Father, I'm not going to tell you." 30 years old, he starts going around and preaching. Oh, the angels say, "That's why he's a prophet, he's a preacher. Hey, now we know, Father, why." "No, you don't. You ain't seen nothing yet." 33 years old, Jesus Christ is delivered up unto Pilate. The Pharisees take him, they strip him, they beat him, they put him on the cross. And the angels are looking from heaven, horrified, saying, "What are they doing?" And Jesus says, "Unto thy hands I commit my spirit, O Father." And he dies. And all the angels in heaven are looking down and just going, "Father." And God the Father says, "Just watch." One day and night passes. 2 days and nights pass. 3 days and nights pass. And all of a sudden, the angels are watching as Mary Magdalene comes to the sepulcher, to the grave. She's carrying all these spices, probably some flowers as well, and all of a sudden she sees the door is open. And she's scared, and she looks in and sees nothing. God up in heaven about that time says, "I want two angels to run down there and give her a message." "Yes, Father, what is it?" "Just go down there." So the two angels are there, and they say, "Mary, he ain't here, he's risen." And then all the angels in heaven said, to die and rise again just to spite the devil. Man, I love the Bible. Can you imagine? All those Old Testament prophets were writing about this and didn't even know what they were writing about. Even the angels had no idea until it happened. And then they said, wow! Never in the history of the world has a God loved people enough to die for him. See, all throughout the Old Testament, all throughout ancient mythology, all throughout Genesis 6 and the giants, the so-called gods demanded sacrifice. And they enjoyed blood and murder and killing of people. They didn't love people, they hated people. But God himself showed the world he loved them enough to die for them. And he did. Then he went and preached to the Jews. But the nation, the hard-hearted, stiff-necked nation, rejected their Messiah. So this started. And then the angel said, okay, starting to make sense. This was all to bring the gospel to the Gentiles, and you're using a guy down there named Paul. Why would you use him, Lord? He was killing Christians. I've got my plan. And God said, Paul, I'm going to reveal some mysteries to you. One of the mysteries about my body. I'm making myself a body. And I'm sure the angel said, wow, I didn't see that coming. God died to make himself a body. Who is that body, Lord? And God says, my body is my bride. Did you know the body of Christ is called the bride of Christ? Jesus Christ suffered and bled and died so he'd have a bride. And when the church, his bride, is taken out, after this 7-year tribulation, Jesus Christ is coming back with his bride. And he's going to rule and reign in the millennial kingdom in his glory with his bride by his side. Now what if that didn't happen? And Jesus just came back. Isn't it nice to have a bride? I'm so happy to be married. It's a wonderful thing to have a wife. Jesus has his bride. Now, 1 Corinthians 12:26. And whether one member suffer, all the members suffer with it. Or one member be honored, all the members rejoice with it. Now look at this. This is so important. Verse 27. Now ye are the body of Christ and members in particular. Ye, the people he's writing to. Who's he writing to? He's writing to Gentiles that got saved. He says, you're the body of Christ. Yet the whole chapter, he's sitting there telling people, yeah, the body of Christ is made up of Jews as well. So the people that were Jews or Gentiles, whoever received the Holy Spirit, is part of the body of Christ. They were baptized with the same Spirit. Now watch this, verse 28. And God had set some in the church, first apostles, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers, after that miracles, then gifts of healing, helps, government, diversity of tongues. So God set some in the church. What is the church? The body. Colossians 1. The body is the church. The church is the body. Well, if he set some in the church and he says, first apostles, who are the apostles? Well, the apostles are Peter, James, John, Matthew. So they're in the church. They're in the body of Christ. Secondarily, prophets. When were there prophets? Let's go to Acts chapter 11. When were there prophets? You see, there's no prophesying today. The Bible's finished. We have the finished Word of God. We don't have people that go around and prophesy. We have people that preach. But in Acts chapter 11 and verse 27, it says, and in these days came prophets from Jerusalem into Antioch. So the Bible says, first apostles, then prophets. And what does it say about them? That they are in the body of Christ. That means the body of Christ must have started with Christ. And that these Jews are in the body. So Jews and Gentiles alike are in the body of Christ. That's what the Bible teaches. He says in verse 29, are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, and are all workers of miracles? No, because they're no longer apostles. We looked at that last time. The gifts and the signs of the apostles are gone. Because that was only for the Jews. It says, are all prophets? No. Are all teachers? Are all workers of miracles? No. The miracles were for the Jews, and those miracles are gone. Paul couldn't heal someone at the end of his ministry because he said, Trophimus have I left in my Miletum sick. Have all the gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? No. No. The tongues was Acts chapter 2 back here with the apostles. The miracles? No, that was for the apostles. And Paul was an apostle. He lost those signs, those miracles. Verse 31, but covet earnestly the best gifts. Now watch this. And yet show I unto you a more excellent way. Now what is the context? The context was signs and wonders in the beginning part of the church. And he says, do everyone have those? He says, no, they don't. You see, those signs, those wonders, those miracles were lost. And then Paul says, now behold, I show you a more excellent way. What is the more excellent way? It's this right here, the gospel. The gospel is 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. Paul said God revealed unto him that gospel, and God told him to go and to preach that gospel to the world, to the Gentiles, even to Jews in his ministry. And in Romans chapter 2 and verse 16, Paul says that God will judge every man according to that gospel. That's how important that gospel is. That's the more excellent way, is through the gospel. In Romans 2:16 it says, in the day when God shall judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ according to my gospel. What is his gospel? Well, let's go there. We're actually getting really close. We're going to be in chapter 13 next time, and then 14, then 15, we're going to reach the gospel. But in 1 Corinthians 15 it says, moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel. Verse 1 through 4 I'm going to read. Which I preached unto you, and also which you have received, and wherein you stand, by which also you are saved. You can only be saved through the gospel today that God gave to Paul, that Paul has preached, and which Paul says all men will be judged according to that gospel. You see, we're no longer under the ministry of the apostles with the signs and the miracles and healings. No longer do we have to be baptized in water to get the Holy Spirit. No, we get saved by trusting the finished work of Jesus Christ, his death, burial and resurrection, his shed blood, and by faith alone in what Jesus did for us, we receive and we're sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, Ephesians 1:13. That's when we're baptized with the Holy Spirit into the body of Christ. That's the more excellent way. 1 Corinthians 15, continuing, says, Verse 3, "For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried and that He rose again the third day according to the Scriptures." What is the gospel? It's what Jesus did. It's how He did it. He died, was buried, and rose again. And what did He do? He did all that for our sins. And now He sits up in heaven. He said, "Paul, come here. Take this to the Gentiles and tell them how to be saved." Because one day everybody will be judged according to that gospel. Are you preaching the gospel? Have you ever heard the gospel? A lot of people have never heard the Bible presented in this way. And it's sad. But it's true. It's what the Bible says. And it's what the Bible calls the more excellent way. I'm so glad I'm not a Jew. Now, there's some debate. My mom says that her maiden name, Schwartz, is a Jewish name. Could be. And she says that her father probably had some Jewish blood, came from over in Mecklenburg, Germany, where Jews probably lived in Germany. So there might be Jewish blood in me. But you know, I'm not safe by the law. The Bible says in Romans 10:4 that Christ is the end of the law to all who believe. It's by faith. Faith in what? Faith in the gospel. I'm not saved by water baptism or by these miracles. I live by faith, not by sight. I don't need miracles. I study the Scriptures, and the Bible tells me, trust this gospel. Trust that blood that Jesus shed for me, because it was for me to save me from my sins and wash my sins away. So I trust Him. I trust Christ. I come to Jesus Christ through the gospel God revealed unto Paul. And I'm saved, and I'm on my way to heaven. And I'm a part of the body of Christ. So that's what 1 Corinthians chapter 12 has to say. So many other things that I could say there. I would love to continue on talking about this, but I don't want to beat a dead horse, as the old saying goes. But I hope you understand that Jesus Christ died for a reason. He died for a body. And He died, and He gave the Jews a chance to be saved. And He told them, look, here's the signs, here's the miracles, here's what proves that I'm your Messiah. Get baptized in water, you'll get the Holy Spirit, and then you can become part of my body. But the nation rejected Him. So God said, now it's time for the Gentiles to get saved as well. And so everybody that God saved, no matter how it was, if it was under this or under Paul's gospel, which we're under today, we're no longer under that. People say all the time, well, I've been baptized in water, so I'm saved. No, you're not. That does not apply to us today. Notice that it didn't say that all people will be judged according to what Peter preached in Acts 2:38. No, Paul says, according to my gospel, you're saved based upon whether you trusted the gospel of Jesus Christ. And when you're saved, you become part of the body of Christ, which one day will leave at the rapture. So that's it. I hope this has been a blessing to you. There's a lot of people out there that probably never heard this. There's other people out there that they like to preach about and talk about the body of Christ, but they wrongly divide and they say the body of Christ started with Paul. But this verse shows without a doubt, verse 28, I believe it's, that the body had to have started with the Jews. Because verse 13 says, by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, both Jew and Gentile. And in verse 18 it says, God set the members, every one of them in the body, as it had pleased Him. It pleased God to do it this way. I might not have done it that way. I think I would have called Paul at the beginning. But it pleased God to do it this way. That's the way God did it. And it's sad that a lot of people don't understand the Bible. A lot of people are thinking that water baptism saves them, because they haven't rightly divided and read the rest of the Bible. So now that you've heard, what are you going to do about it? Are you saved? Are you lost? I knew a lot of people when I was in a charismatic church that still think these signs and wonders and miracles and gifts of healing are for today. They're not. They're not. They have a false hope. They're trying to be healed of certain things, and they don't understand that we live by faith, not by sight. It's not the flesh or anything in the flesh. It's all about the Spirit. And as we looked at last time, the spiritual gifts. So if you're saved, praise God. If you're not saved, get saved. Jesus Christ is coming soon. Don't be left behind and go through the Antichrist reign and the tribulation. Come to Jesus Christ before it's eternally too late. God bless you and thank you for watching. We'll see you next time when we start on 1 Corinthians chapter 13. So thank you for being with us.